Now, having hollowed it out with the small round nose tool, we finish it off with the square tool. But you notice that this armrest comes into play all the time because it holds the tool exactly where you want it. It has no option, it has to go where you want it. You don't have to turn the T-rest sideways and work like that, or like that, which is even worse. And while we're on that subject, I was saying about the jaws of the chuck, and you're frightened of the jaws. Well, a woodturner uses tools like this, sliding along, you see, holding the bevel upwards and the tool cutting from the upwards position. And you slide the way along towards the jaws, and if it slides from slightly too far, your hand goes into the jaws. But not if you use it like this, with your hand underneath, your thumb on top of the tool, and then you can put the tool exactly where you like, and with the additional advantage that you can see every cut of the tool and the shape of the work. Whereas with this, you've half obscured your vision. I'm going to finish this off with a square tool, which has an edge on that side and that. Make a recess at the back with a point tool, and I can use that backwards with the aid of the armrest. Just so the chaser doesn't clong with the bottom. Keep a bit of candle handy to rub on the top of the T-rest. Because the chaser has to slide along, or the armrest has to slide along the top without him being impeded in any way. And when I take the 16 chaser, 16 threads to the inch, and I hold it down slightly like that, just balanced, and lightly slide it into the work in a sort of spiral movement, and it should pick up a thread. That's where the advantage of foot control comes in. Imagine if you had to change your control in the car from an accelerator to the old type of things like that. It's all right in a car, but if you had to just have one fixed speed that you couldn't control easily, it would be highly dangerous.
Yeah.
With the chaser, you can feel with the foot control exactly the speed you want. So with this, I'm not used to it very well. That seems about right. We'll see how it goes. Because although I've been turning threads all my life, the thought always comes into my mind, I wonder if I'm going to be successful this time. But I've only got a couple of thread on a quarter of an inch. Now, if you want to learn to cut inside threads, you want to put a ring something in the chuck so there's no bottom to worry about. And then you slide it right the way along and it makes a perfect thread after one, two, three or four times. As soon as you've struck that perfect thread once, you can cut it away again and do the same thing you did with the same traverse and get a perfect thread, because the possibility of a perfect thread depends on the speed of the lathe and on the traverse in conjunction with that speed. If it's a variance in the slightest, you won't get a thread, or you'll get a drunken thread. And any engineer has to put up change fields to coincide the speed of the lathe with the traverse of the point tool to make the thread. So it would appear to be impossible. So, the only way it can be possible is to develop the knack of striking this thread. It's a little bit difficult. And you might get it first time. Some people might take several days fooling about with it. But it's a simple knack. You don't find everybody learns to swim equally at the same speed, so it might take several weeks going to the bar. But as soon as you've got that first stroke or so, you get your confidence and away you go. The same applies to chasing a thread. But I think swimming, you're better off. If once you know you can swim, you make sure you don't sink. Obviously, I could be sure that I won't sink when I cut this thread. I needn't have worried. See how lovely it goes in? And no pressure on it at all. As soon as you put pressure on, even boxwood might crumble.